Hey guys, welcome back to my channel, The ENT Resident. Today I'll be discussing a short topic, and that is Gradenigo Syndrome. This is important for you as a short note in your exams, theory exams, as well as from the clinical perspective, because this is a Viva question that comes in a case of CSOM. You can also now purchase my notes. I have added links in the description. Okay, so let's get started. Now, what is Gradenigo Syndrome? Now, Gradenigo syndrome is a rare but very serious complication of otitis media, which involves the petrous apex of the temporal bone, and it is characterized by a classical triad of symptoms due to involvement of some cranial nerves. Now, how do we remember this triad? To make it easy, I have a mnemonic for you to remember what is the triad of features you see in Gradenigo syndrome. Now, the mnemonic is ear, E-A-R, ear. E is for ear discharge. So you see persistent otoria in these cases. A is for abducens palsi, which leads to diplopia because of the lateral rectus palsi. And this is only visible on lateral gaze. And R is for retroorbital pain or facial pain. And this happens because of trigeminal nerve involvement. So these are the three features forming the triad of Gradenigo syndrome. And the mnemonic to remember this is ear. E for ear discharge, A for abducens palsi, and R for retroorbital pain. This triad was actually first described by Giuseppe Gradenigo in 1904. So, you know, Gradenigo syndrome, when do we suspect a Gradenigo syndrome? This is actually a very rare complication, but it is a complication of otitis media. You can see it in acute otitis media as well as chronic otitis media. So whenever you see that there is a non-resolving otitis media with diplopia presenting, you should definitely suspect that possibly this is a case of apical petrositis and leading to the formation of Gradenigo syndrome. So now let's understand the anatomy a little bit so as to understand why we are seeing the typical triad of features. Now, the important anatomical part is that this is in relation to the petrous apex. Now, petrous apex is the medial portion. If you see in the image over here, this is the petrous apex. And this is a medial portion of the temporal bone, which is lodged in between the inner ear and clivus. Now, there's two things that is important here. We have seen that there is a fifth and a sixth nerve palsy. Now, that can be explained from this. First of all, there's a structure which is known as Dorello's canal. If you see, this is Dorello's canal. This Dorello's canal is basically a narrow channel through which the abducens or the sixth cranial nerve passes near the petrous apex. And second thing is the trigeminal ganglion, also known as the Gasserian ganglion, this also lies close to the petrous apex. Now, because of these two structures lying close to the petrous apex, we end up seeing the features that I have mentioned above. Now, if we look at the pathophysiology behind the disease, it starts with a middle ear infection, which is otitis media, that can be acute as well as chronic. Now, as the disease progresses, it causes mastoiditis, and then it can spread to the petrous apex via the different air cell tracts that are present. There are two air cell tracts that are present. One is the posterior superior air cell tract, and the second one is an antero inferior cell tract. Now, once it has reached the petrous apex, it is involving the trigeminal ganglion, leading to the retroorbital pain. It is involving the abducens nerve in Dorello's canal, leading to lateral rectus palsi, causing diplopia on lateral gaze. And lastly, if this has continued for a long time without getting treated properly, it can even involve the adjacent dura and the venous sinuses, leading to intracranial spread. Now, coming to etiology, we have already discussed this. This is usually a complication of an acute or chronic otitis media with petrositis. This can happen because of inadequate antibiotic treatment, which leads to the fact that the infection doesn't get treated properly. Gradenigo syndrome is also associated with cholesteatoma, temporal bone trauma, rarely tuberculosis or fungal infections as well. Now we have discussed all the features that we see in Gradenigo syndrome. Now, what will be the investigations that you perform to confirm your diagnosis. Now, the gold standard over here is taking a MRI of the brain. Now, if you see in the image over here, the left one is a T2 weighted MRI and the right one is a T1 weighted MRI. Now, in this, in the MRI brain, we see an inflammation of the petrous apex. There is a cranial nerve enhancement and soft tissue changes. If you see in the arrows that are pointed, the first one is the petrous apex and the second one is pointing towards the mastoid. You can see some high signal intensities in the left petrous apex and the left mastoid. And the second investigation that is important is the CT scan of the temporal bone. Why? Because this will help you in evaluating the bony erosion, petrous apex pneumatization, and mastoid air cells. If you see in the image CT scan over here, on the left side petrous bone, we can see that there is pneumatization of the petrous apex. And it has been seen that pneumatized petrous apex is more at risk of developing petrositis than any other type like sclerotic or diploic. So that's about the investigations. Next is, how will we treat the disease? So first of all, you'll give IV antibiotics for 4 to 6 weeks. Usually third generation cephalosporins are used along with a combination with metronidazole. You'll give analgesics for the pain, and sometimes steroids are given cautiously for cranial nerve inflammation. Even after all of this, if after the medical management has failed, or you see that there is it is leading to more complications, intracranial complications, in that surgery is the only treatment of choice. Now, the different surgeries that you can perform here are mastoidectomy or petrous apex drainage, which we can approach through different routes like the infralabyrinthine, subtemporal, or transcochlear approaches. That's about the treatment for Gradenigo syndrome. Next, what are the complications that can happen as a result of Gradenigo syndrome? If it is left untreated or there's any delay in diagnosis, it can lead to meningitis, brain abscess, lateral sinus thrombosis, sepsis, and even permanent cranial nerve deficits. Now that brings us to the prognosis factor. Now, the cranial nerve deficits that you see in Gradenigo syndrome, do they reverse when you treat the disease? Yes, so this disease has a very good prognosis if you can do an early diagnosis and treat the patient promptly. Most of the cranial nerve deficits resolves with treatment. So this is all about Gradenigo syndrome. This is a typical short note that you get in your theory exams, and it can even come up as a Viva question where you're asked, what is the triad that you see in Gradenigo syndrome and what condition do you see Gradenigo syndrome in? If you have any further questions, please note them down in the comment section and I'll get back to you.